Άμα πάει, άμα δεν κόψει μέχρι παρατέταρτο.
Τον έκλεισε τον άλλον που γράφει.
Λέγεται. Αλέξανδρο, καλημέρα. Μια χαρά. Καλή σου εβδομάδα. Κάνω μια απόπειρα συνδυασμού.
So, we're back to continue our presentation and discuss the next issue, which is the LNG stakeholder demands. So, stakeholders demand that certain criteria must be met for them to invest in or support the implementation of LNG for shipping technology. Some of these demands are critical to the development of an LNG infrastructure, while other demands are not considered critical but are still important requirements. So, with regards to ship owners and operators, ship owners have an essential role to play in creating the new infrastructure for LNG as marine fuel. Without the demand from ship owners to use LNG as a fuel, no infrastructure will be possible. The LNG infrastructure requires a sufficient amount of investment in new LNG fuel ships or the conversion of existing ships to use LNG marine fuel. The first adopters must be prepared to assume the risk of possibly choosing the wrong technology due to the current uncertainty of future costs of using LNG compared to fuel oils and other alternatives. For ship owners will invest in LNG fueled vessels, they are likely to demand the following conditions. Firstly, the price of LNG as marine fuel must be competitive compared to the HFO and cleaning solutions. Secondly, the availability of LNG must be reliable. LNG bunkering infrastructure must be available in most, if not all, ports used by the ship owner. So, there must be an assured availability. The third requirement is that the regulatory framework should be clear regarding design, operations and emissions, while finally, tried and tested bunkering procedures must be in place. The question of whether LNG bunkering can be undertaken simultaneously with cargo handling must be answered, as bunkering must not cause delays or result in longer stays in port. Further on, with regard to policymaker demands, policymakers, such as legislators and governments, at local, regional, and national level, local, regional, national, and EU level, need to show clear support for cleaning shipping technologies, including LNG. Without the support from politicians at all levels, it will be difficult to set up the necessary infrastructure. Policies promoting alternative fuels must be long-term in vision, and the supporting legislation should be harmonized and implemented fairly and consistently across countries and different types of technology. In the early stages of implementation, some form of public financial funding or incentive schemes will probably be required to support the initial investments in LNG vessels and bunkering infrastructure, as well as the work required to establish the necessary regulatory framework. On the other hand, for policymakers to take a standpoint and make important decisions that will be required, they will need credible and unbiased information on LNG as a potential clean marine fuel, addressing both the risks and benefits regarding health, safety, and environment. Any input to the process must be of high quality to support policymakers' decisions. Political decision makers must have a realistic view of the technical and financial challenges posed by LNG and possible implications for other stakeholders. Moving on to the authorities' demands. Authorities, such as transport, safety, environment and similar bodies, are of crucial importance for implementing the LNG for shipping infrastructure. The support of these authorities will be essential for implementing and enforcing the necessary regulatory framework. The regulations should be set at an appropriate level to ensure safety, but be flexible enough to accommodate shipping business operations. The authorities must communicate their requirements to other stakeholders and acquire sufficient knowledge of the LNG infrastructure through either their own or third-party studies. These authorities may be required by politicians to provide many of the expert statements that will inform the decision-making process. The authorities will require clear directives and financial support from the policymakers to complete the research and detailed investigation into what will be required to set up the appropriate regulatory framework. Authorities will also require detailed information from various stakeholders, research organizations, and so on to support their decisions. With regard to port demands, the ports are a crucial part of the LNG supply chain. From a sustainable LNG infrastructure perspective, a sufficient number of ports must make locations available for small-scale LNG terminals and bunker facilities. The Port Authority needs to establish local regulations and port bylaws approved by relevant authorities. In addition, the ports may be a possible source of funding for investment support. For example, the Port of Antwerp is planning to develop an LNG bunker vessel to support the growing interest in using LNG as a marine fuel. Another example is the Port of Gothenburg, which has decided to invest 3 billion SEK in the necessary logistics to offer ships the possibility to bunker LNG. The following points describe some of the general requirements that should be met before port authorities will support the establishment of an LNG infrastructure, such as the available space both on shore and offshore, a sound business case for the port with sufficient LNG fuel demand from the users, while also support from the owners of the port, further on possible internal and external funding, an established regulatory framework, while finally accreditation of bunker companies. With regard to terminal operation demands, terminal operators are independent companies building and operating the LNG terminal on the port premises, where the LNG will be stored and distributed to different customers. If the step is not managed by the port or the gas supplier, the LNG infrastructure demands to support a competent terminal operator who can establish and run the terminal and also offer a realistic contract model for gas suppliers regarding quantities and the contract length, short-term versus long-term. Terminal operators will require sufficient user demand with the potential of economies of scale offered by different types of gas users, such as the energy sector, manufacturing industries, shipping and land transportation, car trucks and so on, other modes of transport. Moreover, the regulatory framework should be in place and external funding may also be necessary to persuade potential operators to commit in investing in a new terminal. The LNG supplier demands. Gas as a fuel for ships is a potentially new market for gas suppliers. Although by comparison to the total gas consumption market, the LNG marine fuel market will be relatively small. If LNG as a marine fuel is going to be an attractive alternative for shipping, the gas suppliers must be able to offer stable gas deliveries and competitive prices compared to other options for fuel and cleaning technologies. Contracts with ship and terminal operators should be reasonable in terms of practice, quantities and length of contract. It is also important that gas suppliers, together with terminal operators, define and adhere to a minimum quality range of LNG. If a gas supplier is going to deliver LNG to ships, there must be a sufficient user demand. The shipping industry will probably take a relatively small share of the total gas deliveries, but with the right location of terminals, there are bunkering opportunities for a large number of ships of different categories and the possible economies of scale advantages for other types of users. The small-scale LNG supply chain is still under development, as is the regulatory framework for using LNG as marine fuel. When the supply chain and the regulatory framework are established, shipping is likely to be a growing market for many gas suppliers. While with regard to the other parts, components of the LNG supply chain, we should include also the demands of the equipment and service suppliers. The various marine technology suppliers are important players in the development of a successful infrastructure for LNG as marine fuel. Engine manufacturers and other equipment and the service suppliers must have the appropriate technology available and the capacity to deliver the necessary equipment to meet the demand. Most of the technology solutions regarding using LNG as fuel are available today, but further improvements are still required. The technology suppliers will continue to develop their equipment if they can expect enough potential demand from ship owners who are ready to upgrade their fleet. Research and education demands. With regard to the research and education demands, as with many new technologies, there is also a need for research and training. Independent studies by research institutions and similar organizations are important to establish a scientific basis for the real cost and benefits of using LNG as marine fuel by comparison to alternatives. Universities and other educational organizations are also important in developing the necessary training courses and educational programs for onboard and onshore crew, authorities and related organizations as to the correct procedures for using LNG as fuel for ships. For these institutions to consider this matter a priority, it may be necessary to issue policy directives and offer financial support to set up research and educational programs. With regard to the generic public demand, to the general public demands, the general public may not be regarded as a direct stakeholder in the development of the LNG or shipping infrastructure. However, their indirect support and acceptance of using this technology is still important. People require safe and environmentally friendly transport at a reasonable price. It may be necessary for other stakeholders to inform and educate the general public about using gas and LNG for shipping. In particular, it seems that safety issues should be addressed and explained, but also the possible environment and health benefits that come with a cleaner fuel alternative. In the end, it is often the wishes of the general public that direct future policies. While finally, we have the non-governmental organization demands, which, as with the general public, non-governmental organization, such as environmental groups, might not be considered as direct stakeholders in developing LNG for shipping infrastructure. However, their indirect and occasionally direct support and acceptance of this technology may prove to be very important. The NGOs will be in favor of safe, clean and environmentally friendly transport. So, after finishing the demands of the LNG stakeholders, we move on to the parameters that should be in place for LNG to be used as a ship fuel. The first parameter with regard to LNG use as ship fuel is the natural gas reserves. It is important to focus on the natural gas resources in the world to determine whether the LNG may be the future of marine fuel. The reserves are substantial and are not fully yet identified. The estimates also continue to grow as new exploration techniques or extractions are discovered. There are two types of reserves. The proven reserves, technically and economically recoverable at a given date, and the potential ones, which are the most important in terms of quantities, but not yet exploited. The proven reserves of natural gas are unevenly distributed around the world, as Russia and the Middle East share about two-thirds of global natural gas reserves. These global reserves have more than doubled over the past 20 years thanks to the discovery of new deposits. According to the International Energy Agency, at current consumption rates, the proven reserves represent approximately 60 years of production. Yet, the exploration and extraction technologies that have been developed provide access to new and very large deposits of natural gas. These findings could represent nearly double the proven gas reserves. In total, the world is assured of having more than 100 years of use. The third of these additional resources would be located in the Asia-Pacific region, including China and the quarter in North America. In this figure, you can see the distribution of the proved natural gas reserves. We can see that in 1992, there was a total 117.6 trillion cubic meters of natural gas reserves. Most of them represent the 37.4% was in Middle East, while 33.7% was in Europe and Eurasia, mainly in Russia, as we said above, while the third region was the Asia-Pacific. As the year passed, 10 years later, we don't see any major change in the distribution. On the contrary, we see that the Middle East has increased in percent, its percent in the global distribution, to 46.3%, while also the European and Europe and Eurasia, despite the fact that increased its extraction of natural gas, its percent fell to 27.1% of the global distribution. Asia, Africa, North America and South and Central America continue to have almost the same percentages as in 1992. Well, finally, in 2012, the total natural gas reserves reached 187.3 trillion cubic meters, again with Middle East being the major player in this market, followed by Europe and Eurasia, Asia, Africa, North America, and finally South and Central America. A second important parameter for the extended use of LNG as a ship fuel is with regard to the fuel costs. From a shipping perspective, the key question is not what the exact price of LNG will be in the future, but what the comparative price of the main alternative will be. Today, heavy fuel oils is the most relevant comparative fuel, even if distillate fuels such as MGO and MDO will increase in importance based on the present and future sulfur emissions regulation in the MARPOL Annex 6. Over time, the price of HFO has allowed the price of crude oil has followed the price of crude oil in an approximate ratio of 0.7 to 0.8%. Consequently, it is useful to compare the estimate prices forecast for crude oil versus natural gas when estimating the relative development of the hub price of LNG with the hub price of HFO. In the short term, the most plausible development is the relative price difference between HFO and LNG will be similar to the present situation, with comparatively low LNG prices in North American market and in principle equal prices in the European market. While on the contrary, in the Asian market, the prices of LNG are comparatively higher. In the long term, predictions become more difficult, but some basic assumptions are still possible. In comparing the proven available resources of natural gas and crude oil, it's clear that future availability of natural gas looks more promising than the availability of crude oil, taking into account the present and future consumption. This should imply that the price for LNG is more unbilling than the price of heavy fuel oils. Further on, crude oil is used as raw material for many industrial processes other than energy and heat production. These processes are in most cases able to pay a premium compared to energy production and is usually not possible to substitute crude oil with natural gas. This would again imply that the price for LNG is more appealing than the price of heavy fuel oils. Thirdly, since the hydrogen-coal ratio is preferable for natural gas compared to crude oil, the contribution of greenhouse gases is reduced when burning natural gas compared to crude oil-related products such as heavy fuel oils. This may make LNG a more attractive fuel for many energy consumption processes in the future, which could imply the comparative price development for natural gas would be higher than for crude oil. Finally, depending on future national and international policies regarding climate change issues, an alternative development is more plausible since any reduction of the market price of crude oil-related products will probably be erased by taxation and other punitive legislation focusing on the reduction of greenhouse gas emissions. So, high viscosity in general, high viscosity, high sulfur fuel, such as HSFO, is the least costly fuel, whereas prices for lighter fuels with less sulfur generally have higher costs. LNG is expected to be less costly than marine gas oil, which will be required to be used within the ECAS if no other technical measures are implemented to reduce sulfur oxide emissions. While considering the plentiful resources, it is projected to provide a lower cost option for ship's fuel, which will contribute to a significant decrease in vessels' operating cost. As we can see in the first figure, the price of natural gas diachronically and for an estimation until 2031 has a slight increase during the years, but despite the fact it's the price is much lower than the residual fuels, which as the years pass they have an increase steeper. They have a slight increase bigger than natural gas, while distillate fuel oils, although in 2012 sloped, their prices fell considerably. From the 2003, from 2013 to 2031, they seem to have an increasing price rate, which will gonna consist it as a less desirable option. So, considering this picture, we can see how, why LNG, in comparison to the other alternative fuels, is the best option with regard to fuel prices and vessels' operating costs. Natural gas is expected to be cost competitive with residual and distillate fuels through 2035. Currently, it is 70% less than residual fuel and 80% less than distillate fuel. Furthermore, the Energy Information and Information Administration expects it to hold this price advantage through 2035. In another case scenario, as we can see where the MGO price level and the LNG price level and compared to the relative prices compared to the HFO price at energy equivalence, we can see six case scenarios in which in the one case with MGO, we have the central and high scenarios. In every case scenario, in the central case scenarios, MGO is relatively 1.6 times the HFO price, while in the high case scenarios, it's 2.2 times the HFO price, which means that in comparison to the HFO fuels, MGO is a much more expensive option for alternative fuels. On the other hand, the LNG price, in comparison to the HFO price, in this case scenarios, we have the low case, the central and the high cases, where in the low cases, the LNG price is 0.5 times the HFO price. In central case scenarios, it's 0.7 times the HFO price, while in the high case scenarios, the LNG price is 0.9 times the HFO price. Although LNG might be, again, LNG might have a relatively higher price than HFO. So, however, in comparison to the alternative, to other alternative fuels such as MGO, could be a best solution for its use as an alternative fuel for ships. The third important parameter with regard to the use of LNG as a ship fuel is the shipping safety. The LNG shipping industry is known for its safety record. Since the first cargoes of LNG were shipped in 1964, there has not been a single incident of LNG loss through a breach of failure tanks, and over 56,000 shipments have been made since then. The robust design of the ships and cargo tanks and extraordinary attention that LNG industry is putting on safety altogether contribute to prevent the release of cargo and a high safety record. More particularly, the LNG industry has technically and operationally involved to ensure safe and secure operations. Technical and operational advantages include everything from the engineering that underlies LNG facilities to operational procedures to technical competency of personnel. The physical and chemical properties of LNG are such that risks and hazards are well understood and incorporated in technology and operations, while finally, the standards, codes and regulations that apply to LNG industry further ensure safety. However, the regulatory framework should be enhanced further on in order to provide a holistic and safe alternative for LNG fuels. However, despite the excellent track safety record, the LNG industry is subject to similar routine hazards and safety considerations that occur in any industrial activity. Therefore, risk mitigation systems must be in place to reduce the possibility of occupational hazards and to ensure protection of onboard personnel, surrounding communities, and of the natural environment. As with any industry, LNG operators must conform to all relevant national and local regulation, standards, and codes. However, beyond routine industrial hazards and safety considerations, LNG presents specific safety considerations for particular hazards. The potential hazards of most concern with regard to LNG are, first of all, the explosions. An explosion happens when a substance rapidly changes its chemical state, is ignited or uncontrollably released from a pressurized state. For an uncontrolled release to happen, there must be a structural failure. Something must puncture the container, or the container must break from the inside. LNG tanks store the liquid at an extremely low temperature of about -256 degrees Celsius Fahrenheit, or -160 Celsius, so no pressure is required to maintain its liquid state. Sophisticated containment systems prevent ignition sources from coming in contact with the liquid. Since LNG is stored at atmospheric pressure, and therefore it's not pressurized, a crack or puncture of the container will not create an immediate explosion. The second identified hazard is vapor clouds. As LNG leaves a temperature-controlled container, it begins to warm up, returning the liquid into a gas. Initially, the gas is colder and heavier than the surrounding air. It creates a vapor cloud, above the released liquid. As the gas warms up, it mixes with the surrounding air and begins to disperse. The vapor cloud will only ignite if it encounters an ignition source while concentrated within its flammability range. Safety devices and operational procedures are intended to minimize the probability of a release and subsequent vapor cloud having an effect outside the facility boundary. Moving on to the third hazard, which is freezing liquid. If LNG is released, direct human contact with a cryogenic liquid will freeze the point of contact. Containment systems surrounding an LNG storage tank thus are designed to contain up to 110% of the tank's contents. Containment systems also separate the tank from the other equipment. Moreover, all facility personnel must wear the appropriate equipment, including wear gloves, face masks, and other protective clothing as a protection from the freezing liquid when entering potential hazardous areas. This potential hazard is restricted within the facility boundaries and does not affect neighboring communities. Moving on, we have the rollover hazard, which when LNG supplies of multiple densities are loaded into a tank, one at a time, they do not mix at first. Instead, they layer themselves in a stable strata within the tank. After a period of time, this strata may spontaneously roll over to stabilize the liquid in the tank. As the lower LNG layer is heated by a normal heat leak, it changes density until it finally becomes lighter than the upper layer. At that point, a liquid rollover would occur with the sudden vaporization of LNG that may be LNG safety and security, too large to be released through the normal tank pressure release valves. At some point, the excess pressure can result in cracks or other structural failures in the tank. To prevent stratification, operators uploading an LNG ship measure the density of the cargo and, if necessary, adjust their uploading procedures accordingly. LNG tanks have rollover protection systems, which include distributed temperature sensors and pump-around mix systems. Another potential hazard is the rapid phase transition. When released on water, LNG floats, being less dense than water, and vaporizes. If large volumes of LNG are released on water, it may vaporize too quickly, causing a rapid phase transition. Whatever temperature and presence of substances other than methane also affect the likelihood of a rapid phase transition. A rapid phase transition can only occur if there is mixing between the LNG and water. While a range from rapid phase transition range from small pops to blasts large enough to potentially damage lightweight structures. Other liquids with widely differing temperatures and boiling points can create similar accidents when they come in contact with each other. Finally, we have the potential hazard of sloshing, where the advent of LNG offshore terminals implies certain risks associated with tanks only partially filled with LNG. Carrying LNG in partially filled tanks could lead to sloshing, a violent motion of the fluid, Sloshing could lead to an increased high temperature of LNG on the tank walls, especially in an abnormal harsh wave environment. Possible sloshing effect might require additional modifications to LNG cargo systems, especially taking into account increasing size of LNG carriers. Several engineering organizations, including the Norsk Veritas, DNV, and Norwegian Maritime Technology Research Institute, have projects underway researching this important safety issue. So, risk management options should be undertaken, focused on approaches that can be used to actively prevent or mitigate the potential LNG hazards. Some risk management approaches that have been considered to help reduce the possibility of an event occurring or reduce the hazards to the vessels and the public should an event occur. Enhanced operational security measures include positive control of other vessel movements during LNG vessel transit and operation, review of LNG vessel escort protocols and operations to improve the ability to enforce exclusion zones through enhanced standoff and active interdiction approaches, review port operational contingency plans to ensure procedures are in place to address larger spills, to include options for moving the vessels to a safe anchorage to monitor, inspect and assess damage for the long-term response options while also including vessel lightering. Further on, review of emergency response coordination and procedures for the LNG vessel, terminal or port, port authority and emergency response groups to reduce the overall impact and consequences of larger spills. Well, finally, review of LNG vessel design, equipment and operational protocols for improved fire protection to the LNG vessels, terminals and vessel personnel from a large LNG fire. So, another parameter after the security and safety conditions, we move to the safe bunkering procedures that should be in place in order to be use LNG as a ship fuel. Successful adoption of LNG as a marine fuel is directly dependent on the safe and effective supply companies. The rules and regulations related to the handling of LNG as cargo have thrived for decades, such as the IMO IGC code, and implemented successfully. Regulatory framework for LNG handling as a marine fuel is under development. Even rules and regulations have been developed to cover the issues of LNG gas as a fuel. Even rules and regulations have been developed to cover the issues of LNG as fuel, have several gaps which should be addressed in order to safe and efficient use. Although the infrastructure for refueling LNG in Europe is still at an early stage, technical and operational aspects of solutions there for the supply of ships is under discussion. Below are three main ways of ship with LNG as marine fuel. The three main ways of refueling are ship-to-ship, truck-to-ship, well, finally LNG from the LNG terminal to ship via a pipeline. As we can understand, each bunkering method requires a different supply chain, and hence a varying investment cost. So, more specifically, the ship-to-ship LNG bunkering operations include: the supply made by ship-to-ship can be performed when the ship is in dock, at anchorage or sea when the vessel is in operation. However, the feasibility of the latter is limited by adverse weather conditions, including strong winds, waves, visibility, presence of ice, as well as currents and tides. All conditions and parameters necessary must be in place to make a good lashing between bunker vessel and the vessel supplied with fuel of LNG. Suitable buffers and appropriate quality and quantity of the mooring lines are necessary parameters for refueling method with ship-to-ship. Even the refueling system must be designed in such a way so as to permit the safe and efficient movement between the vessels involved. Time required to effect the bonding of ships must be based on the turnaround time, which has important implications for the process of supply. For operational reasons and for practical and efficiency of time of such a type of bunker transfer, the quantity of LNG to be supplied by LNG carriers cannot be too small. Volumes that are more than 100 cubic meters are a logical choice for the supply mode. Typical ship capacities for refueling can range from 1,000 to 10,000 cubic meters. The second type of bunkering refueling is from the truck to ship. The supply of specially designed tanker is currently the most widespread form of supply with fuel LNG. The main advantage of the tank is that it is specially shaped to be inexpensive compared to other alternatives. The supply takes place at the pier where the tanker is parked through a system of flexible pipes. A major drawback of this method is that the ship supply is not fast enough, so the supply mode is suitable for small fuel volumes. Moreover, there could be a significant negative impact on operations, which can be performed in parallel with the supply, such as load handling and embarkation disembarkation of passengers, given that the supply is made by the side of the pier. Another obvious limitation is that the preferred site for its refueling should be linked by road to filling station LNG, which should have special facilities and equipment in order to be able to allow the loading and unloading of tankers. Finally, another drawback is the average bunkering rate in this way of bunkering operation, which is 40 cubic meters per hour and is the slower among the three possible bunkering operations. Finally, we have the LNG terminal to ship via pipeline bunkering procedures, where the refueling via pipeline connection with terminals LNG is the third refueling method. This method is ideal for delivery at high rates and for large fuel qualities, which means that the supply can be carried out in a short time. This is an appropriate solution for ships operating voyages on short duration, high frequency, and in high frequency ports with low fuel delivery volumes, such as tugs and feeder vessels. Depending on the requirements and choices of the logistics of the size of the LNG storage tank, it ranges from very small, 20 cubic meters, to very large, 100,000 cubic meters. Access to the pier and the distance between the source and the ship are key factors for the success of the method via supply duct. Main limitations in this approach is the distance of the tank from the refueling point. Long distance makes it hard to replenish with LNG through piping directly from the terminal, both technically and operationally and economically. There should thus be close proximity of the storage tanks of the piers where operations are refueling. Flexibility is not a characteristic of the supply mode, as the supply position remains constant and therefore the various activities that can take place in the port. However, it is possible to use barges, which will act as intermediate terminals, making this method more flexible. The supply pipeline is suitable for use in harbors or piers that have a stable and long-term demand for fuel delivery, or when the local demand for supply vessels coincides with the demand from other consumers, resulting into a sharing of infrastructure. So, each method of bunkering procedure, as we can see, has its advantages and disadvantages. The ship-to-ship offers flexibility and high transfer rate, as well as the ability to supply large quantities of fuel and refueling the vessels at sea. While the disadvantages that appear, among the disadvantages, we can assume that it will have a high investment cost and a high operational cost. With regard to track-to-ship bunkering procedures, the advantages include flexibility, the small investment and operational cost, while among the disadvantages, we can distinguish the small fuel quantities that can be transferred and the low transfer rate. Finally, from transport from the terminal to the sea via the pipeline offers non-flexibility, ability to supply a large quantity of fuel and a fast supply, while among the disadvantages could be said that a fixed refueling point is required, while also the pipeline and the facilities take up much space of the terminal. The ship-to-ship supply is flexible, of delivering large quantities of fuel in a relatively fast pace, but has high investment and operating costs. The supply from the reservoir through pipelines is also a quick refueling way to transport large quantities efficiently. However, this solution requires a fixed point for refueling and may not be suitable for all types of ships. Tanks are the most inexpensive investment, a functional, flexible solution, but it's suitable only for small quantities of LNG. Moving on to the parameters of that should be in place in order to use LNG as a fuel ship, natural gas technologies are required. Another reason for natural gas becoming viable as shipping fuel is the new technological developments which make it able to compete with standard ship fuels. There are four main options for propulsion systems using gas as fuel in ships today. Each one of these options has its advantages and disadvantages depending on the situation. The first possible option is the dual fuel engine. A dual fuel engine can work in two different operation modes. In a diesel mode, it uses only diesel, and in gas mode, it uses gas and small quantity of diesel. In gas mode, the gas is mixed with air and compressed before ignited by a certain quantity of pilot fuel. These types of engines need to run in diesel mode during startup until it has a stable process. Then, switching to a gas mode is possible if wanted. Switching between modes does not cause loss of power and speed. The principal advantage of a dual engine is the flexibility to use diesel fuel or gas depending on the possibility of refueling or regulation zone. The decision between which fuel to use depends on varying fuel prices and emission zones. Among the disadvantages of this engine is that it needs more expensive double feeding system. Second, moving forward, the second option where is the gas engine, which only uses gas and is ignited by a spark plug. The gas is mixed with air before the inlet valves. After that, the mixture is compressed and finally is ignited by a sparking plug. The main advantage of this engine is that it is possible to use lower quality gas with methane number 70 or higher, while the dual fuel engines need the gas methane number 80 or higher. Also, the performance is better than the dual fuel engine. On the other hand, this engine offers no flexibility and therefore needs a secure availability of LNG. The third option is gas turbines, which are machines requiring less weight and volume than engines, around 1/4 in weight and 1/7 in volume, and they can create a lot of power. These two characteristics are actually their best advantage. On the other hand, these machines have a higher consume between 30 and 40% more, and a bad performance working to middle and lower power. These two disadvantages, joined to ships requiring reserve power, the gas turbines are not used so much in the maritime industry. Sometimes these kinds of turbines are used in naval ships, little fast ferries, and ships with high power requirements like cruise ships. Finally, we have the steam turbine. The steam turbine works with the steam that is generating boilers. The boilers use gas to produce water steam. Traditionally, steam turbine plants were used by LNG carriers, but this tendency has changed with the development of a new range of dual fuel engines or medium and high power. The reason is that steam turbine systems require more space, and have about 10% lower efficiency than diesel engines. At this point, we'll make a break and we'll continue to end our presentation.
Τι ώρα θα έρθει ο Τζανέτος.